All right. Now, last week, we did, if you're just new here, this is the story. It's the Bible's big picture. So we're kind of flying over a lot of stuff. And last week, we flew over the first 12 chapters of Acts, skipping the conversion of Saul in chapter 9. Now, Saul is, of course, better known as Paul. So, I mean, that's Saul, better known as Paul, Saul being his Jewish name, and Paul being his Greek name, or the Greek equivalent that he would have commonly used in the Greco-Roman world of his day. Now, Luke refers to him as Saul prior to chapter 9, and then he usually refers to him as Paul, but there are exceptions to that. In Acts chapter 9 through 13, you see a number of places after Paul's conversion, he's still referred to as Saul. Acts chapter 13, verse 9 says, "But Saul, who was also called Paul." You see, so he has a Jewish name and he has a Roman name. And so he uses the Roman name in the Greco-Roman world of his day, Saul being his Hebrew name. And though many think that God changed Saul's name to Paul at his conversion, that doesn't seem to be the case. But we have Saul, who's better known as Paul, and his conversion. He was a Jew from Tarsus in Cilicia, and he was a Roman citizen. He was a Pharisee. You know that sect of Judaism? You had different flavors of Judaism. He was a Pharisee, and he was a scholar of Judaism. Paul was a Jew. He was a scholar. He had been schooled or taught at the feet of the famous rabbi, the renowned rabbi Gamaliel. And you'll recall that Paul approved of the stoning of Stephen. And in the aftermath of Stephen's murder, Paul was aggressively throwing men and women, Christians, into jail. In fact, he was so strongly opposed to the Christian faith because he thought it was wrong. He thought it was heretical. He was so strongly opposed to the Christian faith that he got permission, after he's throwing people in jail in Jerusalem, he got permission to go to Damascus and to go to the synagogues there and to drag back Jerusalem any who were disciples of Christ. So he's going looking for Jewish believers in Christ. He's there throwing them in jail in Jerusalem. He's going to go to Damascus and get them. And that's his plan and intention. But the Lord had something else in mind for Paul. The Lord had something else in mind for him. And as Paul was on his way to Damascus, the resurrected Lord Jesus appeared to him. Paul was told to go into Damascus, where he'd be told all that he was to do. And having been blinded, he was led by the hand into Damascus, where he spent 3 days fasting and praying to God. And God gave him a vision that Ananias would come to him. And that Ananias would come to him. And when Ananias arrived, he told Paul that God had chosen him, Paul, to be a witness to the world for Jesus Christ. Well, that's quite a turnaround. Jesus appears to him. You remember, "Who are you, Lord? I'm Jesus whom you're persecuting." He's blinded. He goes into Damascus, 3 days fasting and praying. God says, "Ananias is going to come to you." Ananias comes to him and says, "You're going to be a witness to Jesus to the world." Quite a turnaround. From being somebody who's persecuting Christians to now you're going to be testifying about him throughout the world. And Ananias famously said to him, "And now what are you waiting for? Get up, be baptized, and wash your sins away, calling on his name." Now, I could stop and talk about that for quite a while. But Paul does that. Paul gets up and he complies. And his conversion is probably around A.D. 33. Now you have, maybe it's a little earlier, maybe a little bit later, but that's a good estimate of when this occurs at A.D. 33. And from Damascus, where Paul is converted, he immediately goes into Arabia, meaning Nabatea, which is the area around Damascus. So Paul is converted. He immediately goes into Arabia and then he returns to Damascus. And there he spends time. He's confounding the Jews. The text says in Acts 9:22, by proving that Jesus was the Christ. So he's taking them to their text. He's taking them to their scriptures. And he's proving that Jesus was the Christ. Well, the Jews in Damascus plotted to kill him. And he was there about 3 years, so around AD 36, he escapes from Damascus. The Jews, he's so irritated by proving to them that they're wrong and that Jesus is the Christ. They're ready to kill him and they're watching the city gates. So, you know, this is the way in and out of the city. So they got their people and they said, Paul comes, we're going to kill him. So Paul escapes from Damascus in this very humiliating way of being lowered down the city wall in a basket. See, so he didn't have to go through the gate. They lowered him down in a basket on the city wall. Paul escapes there. And then Paul went to Jerusalem for 15 days. Now, you have to see this. When you look at the autobiographical information that's in Galatians, you see that his visit to Jerusalem at that time was for 15 days, during which time he saw Peter and James. Luke simply says he saw the apostles. Barnabas takes him there and introduces him. But Paul says in Galatians that the apostles he saw, it's Peter and James, and he's there just for 15 days. And his stay was so short because the Greek-speaking Jews, the Hellenists, those who this is their first language that we talked about last week, the same crew that was behind the stoning of Stephen, they did not like. Paul was arguing with them. So Paul's converted. He's in Damascus, Arabian Damascus, for 3 years. He comes here to Jerusalem, and he's on those same Hellenistic Jews who had been behind the stoning of Stephen, telling them, you're wrong, that Jesus is, in fact, the Christ. Well, they didn't care for that much either, and so they're ready to kill Paul. And so Paul was sent away to Tarsus by the brothers. He was taken to Caesarea, and then he was sent to Tarsus because the Jews there were in Jerusalem were trying to kill him. Okay, so he goes to Caesarea, and then they send him to Tarsus, which is his hometown. Now, we saw last week that with the stoning of Stephen, which occurred prior to Paul's conversion, so we saw that with the stoning of Stephen, that a great persecution broke out against the church in Jerusalem. And as a result, the disciples, they moved into Judea and into Samaria. And so this was something that happened in that aftermath. And then some years later, probably around AD 40. Okay, so Paul's conversion, maybe 33. You have before that, you have the persecution. They go out into Judea and Samaria. Paul is converted. And sometime later, probably in AD 40, is when God in Acts chapter 10 sent Peter to convert the Gentiles at Cornelius' house. And we looked at that last week. So this is probably around that time. And then you recall that a large number of Gentiles, they converted to the faith in the city of Antioch. And if I can get this little guy, you see up here. So Jerusalem's down here and you have a large number of Gentiles who accept the gospel here in Antioch. And when the church in Jerusalem heard about that, you remember they sent Barnabas up there. And this is probably around AD 44. Okay, so we're talking about maybe 10, 11 years after Paul's conversion and some 8 years after he was sent back to Tarsus. But they sent Barnabas up to Antioch, and the church in Antioch grew. And in the next year or two, Barnabas, so we're now for like 45, 46, with some wiggle room, but maybe 45, 46, Barnabas is there, the church grows, maybe 45, 46, Barnabas found Paul in Tarsus, he found Paul in Tarsus. You got to watch that tongue. But he goes to Tarsus, he finds Paul, and he brings him back to Antioch. Now, Paul had no doubt been preaching in Tarsus and Cilicia, but we don't have any details about what he was doing here. You know, Paul is on fire for Christ. He's no doubt teaching in Tarsus and in the surrounding area in Cilicia, that region, but we really don't have any details. But Barnabas goes over to Tarsus. He gets Saul, brings Saul to Antioch, and the Christians in Antioch, this is when they decided, look, to send financial support to the saints in Judea because of this prophesied coming famine. A prophet comes and says there's a famine coming. They say, listen, we need to send some aid down there to the brothers and sisters down in Judea. So they sent Barnabas and Paul to deliver that aid to the elders. And we talked about that last week. Now, they sent it to deliver. Now, this is around AD 47. And Paul brought Titus along. Now, you have to look in Galatians to see that. You see, but Paul brought Titus along then, and he took the occasion privately to present the gospel he preached to those who seemed to be pillars, James, Peter, and John. So he goes and he meets with them privately, and Paul wants to set before them the gospel that he preaches because he wants to make sure that the church is unified. And so he sets that before them privately during that time. You see that in Galatians chapter 2. And he says they added nothing to his message, meaning they didn't change it. You see that they accepted and embraced the gospel that Paul preaches. So he says they added nothing to his message, and they gave Paul and Barnabas the right hand of fellowship. And Titus, he mentions there, was not compelled to be circumcised, even though he was a Gentile, a Greek convert. So he took him to Jerusalem. And he says, I set before them privately the gospel that I preached. They gave us the right hand of fellowship. They didn't change it. And even Titus wasn't compelled to be circumcised. And that has some significance, because in this whole Gentile Jewish thing, as you know, that's a significant point. That's why he mentions it in Galatians. In Acts chapter 12, that ends with Barnabas and Paul returning to Antioch from Jerusalem, having been sent by Antioch to deliver this famine relief. They go back at the end of chapter 12. They return to Antioch from Jerusalem, and they brought with them Barnabas's cousin, John, who's also called Mark. Now, as I say, we don't like that, but that's how it rolls. John, who's also called Mark. And they bring Barnabas's cousin with them, and he will, in later years, compose the Gospel of Mark. So he's in on it, you see. He's there. He's a really good guy to be, he's in the know. So he's up there. Now, at Antioch, the Holy Spirit called Paul and Barnabas to go on a missionary trip, and the church in Antioch sent them off. Now, this is probably A.D. 47, 48 when this occurs. And so the Holy Spirit calls them to a mission trip. The church there sends them off, and John Mark came along, and his role was to assist them. So John Mark joins them and travels. He's coming with them. And they first went to the island of Cyprus. And you see here, they leave from Antioch and they sail down to Cyprus. And they go to the synagogues there. They go to the synagogues and preach the word of God to the synagogues in Salamis. And they went throughout Cyprus preaching, coming finally to Paphos. They come to this city, and that's where they were preaching to the proconsul. This fellow who's a Roman official, who's got some juice in this city, and his name is Sergius Paulus. And there's a Jewish magician, a false prophet, a man named Elymas, who sought to prevent the proconsul Sergius Paulus from accepting what Paul and Barnabas were saying to him about Jesus. He's over here working for the enemy, trying to pull them away from that. And then the Lord, as announced by Paul, Paul announces this, but the Lord is the one doing it, blinded Elymas for a period of time. And Sergius Paulus believed. You see, he saw this is going on. They're preaching this message. He's interested. This guy's over here saying, no, don't believe this. Don't believe it. Don't believe this. And Paul announces, because you're an enemy of the way, you see. And so this guy then is like, and so Sergius Paulus goes, this looks like a serious vindication of what these guys. The timing is suspicious as Paul announces this. You see, all right, well, the team then, they sailed to Perga in Pamphylia. They left Paphos. They went up and they sailed, you see here. After that, they sail up here to Perga in the region there of Pamphylia. And that's where John Mark left them. And he returned to Jerusalem. Remember, he was from Jerusalem, and they took him back to Antioch with them. And then he leaves when they go there, and he returns to Jerusalem, and that'll have some significance later, as you know. Now, Paul and Barnabas, they push on to Antioch in Pisidia. Well, you see, there are a couple of Antiochs, right? You see, there's Antioch here, and there's Antioch in Pisidia. Well, just like we have in different states, we've got the same cities. All right, well, there's Antioch, where this great Gentile church is. And then there's Antioch in this region up here in Pisidia. Well, they go on there. Now, the southern part of the Roman province of Galatia, you see, there's an ethnic Galatia, which is further north where the Galatians live. But there was also a Roman political province of Galatia. and the political province of Galatia encompassed these cities down here, Antioch, Iconium, Lystra, and Derbe. They're in the southern part of the province of Galatia. So they push on, they go to Antioch in Pisidia, and their message there generated a great deal of interest, but the Jewish leaders began arguing with them about it, contradicting them, reviling them, speaking abusively toward them. And you see this pattern so many times. And so they wound up doing that, and the Jewish leaders, they stirred up persecution. But after they're speaking that way up to them, when they are reviling them, and then Paul and Barnabas said they were turning to the Gentiles. You say, okay, we're preaching this to you. You guys are reacting this way. They told them that they were going to turn to the Gentiles, and many of the Gentiles believed. They were eating this up. They said, this is good news. And many of them believed, and then the Jewish leaders stirred up persecution, and they drove Paul and Barnabas out of their district. But Paul and Barnabas, it says, shook the dust from their feet against them. See, which is a symbol. It's a symbol of abandoning them to their own hardness of heart and went to Iconium. They didn't stop there and go, oh, please, please, is there some way? Can't we accommodate you in some way? They presented the truth to them. They told it to them repeatedly and plainly, and the people jumped on them and rejected it, and they shook their dust off and said, okay. You've had the opportunity of life given to you. And so then they abandoned them to their hardness of heart and they went to Iconium. Now, both Jews and Greeks in Iconium, they believed, but unbelieving Jews stirred up hostility toward all of the believers. And they stayed there for a good while and God worked many miracles through them there. But the city was divided. And you can see you've got these voices that were going, no, no, that's not true. That's not how it is. That can't be right. No, no. So you see, I mean, how do societies get divided? Well, you got these voices and you've got, they're attracted. They draw people over here. And so the people who were accepting and embracing the message of the gospel, they saw the miracles and all these things. They believed. But you have that the city was divided. And when Paul and Barnabas, they learned of a plot to stone them, they were going to kill them. Just stone them to death. And I want you to see what is involved here in Christian life. And we think that we're going to float through society and the world and be unscathed and be in a bubble and be protected from hatred and hostility and abuse. It's not happening. You see, it's not happening. But here there's this plot to kill them. And when they learned of that, they fled then to the town of Lystra. Okay, right down here. So they come over here. Now they're down in Lystra in this region. And at Lystra, God, through Paul, healed a man who'd been crippled from birth. Now, that'll get your attention. As I said, that's not like an earache. He heals a man who was crippled from birth. And the people, you remember, this is when their people are just freaking out. When they saw this, they said, these guys are gods. They're gods. Barnabas, they called Zeus. Paul, they called Hermes because he's the chief speaker. And they wanted to sacrifice to them. Because they said, the gods have come down and visited us. How else could you explain such an insane miracle? And so Paul and Barnabas are like, they're like freaking out. They're thinking, no, man, you can't be doing that. Look, we're mere humans. And they're telling them, this isn't about us, but this is about the one true God to whom you need to turn. This isn't about us. We're ambassadors, representatives, apostles. People who are sent out, messengers, sent out with this message. You need to turn to the one true God. Well, Jews come from Antioch and Iconium. You see, they're dogging these guys. They are dogging these guys because they are convinced this is not true. Despite all that Paul, when he proves to them, they won't accept the proof. And so they wind up, they come down there and they come from Antioch and Iconium to oppose them, and they succeeded in winning the crowd. And you say, well, how can that be? At one point they're going to sacrifice to them. Look, you know how politics works. You know how power is used and things like that. And so they wind up with their people persuading the crowds, winning the crowd over, and Paul was stoned. Big rocks, boom, boom. He's stoned, dragged from the city, and left for dead. That's how bad he was mangled. This sounds very unpleasant to me. Okay? But he's left for dead there. But God had mercy on him. The brothers and sisters, they gather around him. Paul stands up. And the next day, he and Barnabas went to Derbe. And it's probably during this trip in Lystra, by the way. It's probably this visit to Lystra that Timothy's mother Eunice and his grandmother Lois became Christians. You see, this is Timothy's town, Lystra. And it's probably this trip that Eunice, the mother, and the grandmother, that Paul and Barnabas there successfully in converting them to the Christian faith. Well, they go to Derbe over here. You see, they go here to Derbe. And in Derbe, Paul and Barnabas preached the gospel and they made many disciples. People are hearing this, they're going, yes. So they made many disciples. They then backtracked. They went back through the towns. They go back through these towns, back through Lystra, Iconium, and Antioch. And, you know, it's been a rough place. But they went back through those towns, strengthening the saints and encouraging them to continue in the faith. Because they knew, look, we need to go back and see these people. We've converted them, we've taught them, but we've been gone. And we need to go back and tell them, hang, you be faithful. I know there's all kinds of stuff in the culture and in the world that's after you, that is trying to marginalize you, that is trying to push you from faith, but you be true to the faith. So they went back and they strengthened and encouraged the saints in these various cities, and they appointed elders for them in every church. Why? Because that's important. Because we have to have people who have some deeper grasp of the faith, and they are to function in a shepherding capacity. And this is something we're talking about in terms of, our society doesn't like church. And we have this false idea that in Christianity, you can be a Christian and be your own little guy. I don't care about the church. The church is biblical. Do you see? It's not an option for you to create your own Christian faith that doesn't have a church. The church is the community of faith. And the church has an organizational structure. Well, I don't like it. I didn't ask you if you liked it. The question is that what God has shown to us? And the answer is yes. And so you don't have the option of being the Lone Ranger and saying, I'm really spiritual. I never go to church. I've transcended church in my great spirituality. Well, you need to learn some things because Christianity is communal. And they go back and they appoint elders of these groups because they will shepherd the flock and they will help the people in their spiritual lives. Okay? And so this is what they do. They appoint the elders there and they told them that through many tribulations we must enter the kingdom of God. Through many tribulations, hardships, suffering, difficulties. The point is that the road of faith in Christ is not an easy one as we live awaiting Christ's return, the consummation of the kingdom. That through many tribulations, we must enter the kingdom of God. That you and I are going to be called and we're going to have difficulties and hardships and suffering. Why? Why did they crucify Jesus? Why did they crucify the sinless, loving, perfect Son of God? Is it because they had some reason that was justifiable? Or is it because sin rages against the light? Answer, B. Sin rages against the light. And so, look, that's how it is. And so you wind up seeing that happens and Paul tells them that. Now, they go back to Perga. They go to Perga. They spoke the word there. And then they went down to Attalia. Now, this is down. Sometimes I get confused with down. But they go with what's up. Like, you're always going up to Jerusalem. I'm thinking, no, that'd be north. No, up. Okay. And then they go down to Attalia. And from there, they sail back to Antioch. Arriving back there probably 48. That'd be a good guess. A.D. 48. And they reported to the church all that God had done and how he'd opened the door of faith to the Gentiles. And they remained at Antioch, Luke says, no little time. So they're back here at Antioch. Now, it may have been during this time, say 48, 49, when they're back in Antioch after this first missionary visit, that Peter came to Antioch. It could have been earlier when Paul was in Antioch. But it may have been at this time that Peter came to Antioch and Paul opposed him to his face for pulling back from the Gentiles under the influence of certain men from Judea. In Galatians chapter 2, verses 11 to 16. That may have happened then. But this time when they're in Antioch around 48, 49, in that period, this was certainly the time when certain men came from Judea teaching that one must be circumcised, one must become a Jew, one must submit to the law of Moses in order to be saved. This was a tremendous issue in the early church. How do Gentile Christians relate to the Jewish faith? And you have people saying, okay, I see that God has opened the faith to Gentiles. They are included. But you have people saying, yes, but they have to come as Jewish Gentile Christians. They must become Jews and then be Christians. What they cannot be are Gentile Christians as Gentiles. And that's really what's driving this, and that's what drives a lot of the opposition to Paul. And so you have this where you have these people come to Antioch, and Paul and Barnabas argued strongly against him. So whatever influence, if you remember when Peter was there and he pulled back so that even Barnabas went wobbly, whatever wobble there was in Barnabas, Paul has apparently gotten his mind right. Because when these people come, Paul and Barnabas are arguing with them and challenging them and telling them that that's not right. And it was also sometime around this time that Paul writes Galatians. This is when Paul writes Galatians 49, maybe. And he writes it back to the churches in the southern province of Galatia that he had visited on his first missionary journey. And you see that they too were experiencing problems from these Judaizers. Paul writes to combat the inroads that these Judaizers had made in these churches by saying, no, you know, that's all right, Jesus is wonderful, but you have to be circumcised and you must obey the law. And Paul's like pulling his hair out. See, Paul writes Galatians around this time, and he says, listen, he's adamant that this doctrine, this Judaizers' doctrine, that Gentiles must convert to Judaism and come under the law of Moses, which has now been rendered obsolete. That they must come under the law of Moses and be circumcised and do all that the law requires. Paul says, look, that's a destructive heresy. That's why, remember, say, if I or an angel from heaven preached you a gospel other than one, then you let him be eternally condemned. As I said, I'm saying again. All right, this is serious business. He says that. This is serious business. Well, Paul, Barnabas, and some others were sent to Antioch, from Antioch, to Jerusalem, to meet with the apostles and the elders down in Jerusalem to address this dispute about God's will regarding Gentile salvation. This is the Jerusalem Council that you see in Acts chapter 15. Now, they agreed by the Holy Spirit. That's often overlooked. It's as though, well, we have this council and we go down here and we'll just do this. They agreed by the Holy Spirit. And you can see that in Acts 15, 28, that Gentiles didn't need to become Jews in order to be saved, but they could be saved as Gentiles. Now, they added some requirements that I don't have time to go into. But it may well be that those requirements, you know, were simply to keep them from going to participating in pagan temple feasts. But they say, look, you don't have to become a Jew to be saved. You can be saved as a Gentile. And then they took the letter of this wonderful news and they delivered that letter back up to the church in Antioch with Barsabbas and Silas, two leading men. They took the letter there. And then, so they return, they carry the letter. Paul and Barnabas, who'd come down there with other people to be part of this, looking into, trying to address this question. Paul and Barnabas then return with them to Antioch, and Paul and Barnabas stayed there teaching and preaching in Antioch. Now, at the end of Acts 15, Paul tells Barnabas, look, we ought to go back and visit the churches that we planted on that missionary journey. And they went, he says that, but they went their separate ways because they couldn't agree on whether to take John Mark, Barnabas's cousin. Because you remember, John Mark had left them. He left them early on and he went back to Jerusalem. And for whatever reason, Paul's judgment, you see, Christians don't always agree on everything. Paul's judgment was it was not wise to take him. Barnabas disagreed. Okay, they disagreed. So what you have is Barnabas and John Mark, they then go off to Cyprus. But Paul takes Silas over land and they go. See, they're going to go over here. They go through Syria and into Cilicia. So they go from Antioch over land, and that's where they're headed. See, so he chose him. That's where they wind up going. And as they go through there, in Syria and into Cilicia, they strengthen the churches that had been planted in those regions, in up north in Syria and in Cilicia. Well, were these churches that Paul had preached during that time, Paul had planted during that time he was preaching in Tarsus? Maybe. Or are these churches that simply grew out of this tremendous Gentile congregation in Antioch? We're not told. But on their way, they strengthened churches that exist there. And then they went to Derbe, as you see. Remember, they'd gone to Derbe before. Backtracked, came back. Now Paul overland goes back to Derbe. And then he goes to Lystra, which is Timothy's town. And this is probably AD 49-50, roughly, okay, that they go back there to Timothy's town. Now, Timothy was a Christian, and he had a good reputation with the brothers in Lystra and Iconium. Now, he had presumably been taught by his mother, Paul and Barnabas, who had converted his mother and grandmother on their first trip. They presumably had converted Timothy along with the elders that had been appointed there in Lystra. And Paul wants to take Timothy with him. He says, here's this young man. He got a great reputation. I want to take him with me. And it's probably at that time that Timothy received a spiritual gift, a gracious endowment for ministry, the giving of which was accompanied by the laying on of hands by the elders and Paul, and by a prophetic announcement or recognition of the gift. Now, you see that in 1 Timothy. So I'm trying to put a lot of different things together to tell a bigger story. Okay, but you see that now Paul had Timothy circumcised as a matter of evangelistic expediency. And there's more to say here. Remember Titus? He said, no way, Titus be circumcised. Why? Because it's different if somebody comes up and says, listen, Titus has got to be circumcised or he can't be saved. It's a matter of the gospel truth. Paul would say, drop dead, that's not happening. But in terms of voluntarily doing it to ease as an evangelistic strategy where he's going, he was willing to do it. Okay, so he has Timothy circumcised just as a matter of evangelistic expediency. And then Timothy accompanied Paul and Silas here on this journey. Now, the Holy Spirit forbids them from preaching in Asia and Bithynia. You see, here's Asia. It's pointing at me. It won't work. Asia and up here in Bithynia. You see these two regions. The Spirit prevents them from preaching up there. We're not told why. Okay, the Spirit's apparently sending them somewhere, but prevents them from preaching in those regions. So they pushed on to Troas. And this is when Paul received the vision of the Macedonian man urging them to come to Macedonia to help them. So Paul sees this and says, that's God calling me to go to Macedonia. And so immediately, or they promptly sailed from Troas. They sailed from here in Troas to Samothrace, then to Neapolis, and then they went overland to the principal city of Philippi. So they go over there. They then go to Philippi. They travel to that leading city. Now, in Philippi, you remember this is where Lydia, who's a Gentile convert to Judaism, she's from the city of Thyatira. She's a businesswoman. But she's a Gentile convert to Judaism. And Lydia there, she's converted. This is also where Paul cast out the spirit of a fortune-telling slave girl. And so the owners didn't like that because they were making money off her. And so when he cast that spirit out of that fortune-telling slave girl, they wind up then owners. They bring Paul and Silas before the city, the authorities, on charges of disturbing the city and practicing unlawful things. They're upset that they've cost them money, so they get everything and they drag them here in front of the authorities. And they say, listen, this is what they're doing. And they were beaten and thrown in prison with their feet fastened in stocks. You know, where they lock your ankles down. And I said, I told somebody yesterday, they wouldn't even have to beat me. My back would hurt so much from having my legs stuck there where you couldn't, you know, it would just be horrible. But they beat them. And then they threw them into prison in those stocks in the inner prison. And that night, you know what Paul and Silas are doing. They're praying and singing hymns to God. They had been beaten. They were in stocks in the inner prison. And they're praying and singing hymns to God. What would I be doing? I tell you what, the whine factor would be serious. Okay? But they're praying and singing hymns to God. All the people are hearing him. There's the great earthquake and the prison doors, you know, they fly open. The prisoners' bonds drop off. Okay, this is God working. This isn't just your everyday earthquake. Their bonds fall off. And the jailer's ready to kill himself because he understands that if people under his charge escape, he's going to be killed. So Paul says, no, don't do that. We're all here. And this led to this man and his household being baptized into Christ. Then the next day, the authorities, they sent word to Paul and Silas. They said, look, it's okay. You guys are cool. You can leave. And this is when Paul says, no. That's not happening. We're Roman citizens, and the beating you gave us was illegal for Roman citizens. So now you come down here and you escort us out personally. Now, there's a message in that. You see, there's a message in that. Too many Christians think that if you want to stand up, if you get your sermon subpoenaed, well, then you ought to just fork them over. I'm happy to have them. Anything I say they can have. But they have no legal right to take those things. No legal right. And so Paul tells them, you beat me illegally. And so then they come down and they say, okay, they were afraid when they heard they're Roman citizens. They say, okay, please be gone. Will you please go on your way? And so they then go and they stop off. They stop at the household. They're let out. They stop and visit Lydia. And then they departed. And they went through Amphipolis and Apollonia. And then they come to Thessalonica. These things get kind of small here. But they go from Philippi to Amphipolis, to Apollonia, and then right there is Thessalonica, that little dot there, you see the arrow pointing to it. And then they wind up in Thessalonica. And Paul reasoned with the Jews from the Scriptures, explaining and proving that it was necessary for Christ to suffer and rise from the dead. Sometimes in the religious world, we think reason is not good. We think, no, that religion is mystical. Well, what is Paul doing reasoning with them? You see? It's not like if you become Christian, let me just kind of plug in. And, you know, you see, Paul would go in and say, here is the word. He would reason with them and prove to them from Scripture that the Christ had to suffer and die. So there's nothing wrong with reason. Reason is good. Thinking is good. Logic is good. Okay? It's crazy to have to say that. But there you have it. Okay, so he explained and proved that. Now, he declared to them that Jesus is the Christ, and some Jews were persuaded, as were many Greek converts to Judaism, and some leading women. The image that's sometimes given, you know, women didn't do anything in the ancient world. Well, you had leading women in the city. You had Lydia, who was a businesswoman. And so some of them, they believed, and the Jews again stirred up hostility against them. And the brothers then sent Paul and Silas. They sent them to Berea. So here they are in Thessalonica. Then they send them over to Berea because things are hot and they're going to get killed or something. So they send them over to, they send them to Berea. And it's unclear precisely how long they had stayed in Thessalonica. It's not clear. Now, the fact Paul worked at his trade there, you see that in 1 Thessalonians. Paul worked at his trade while in Thessalonica, and he received aid from the Philippians. So that suggests that they're there longer than 3 weeks, but however long it was, it almost certainly was not longer than a couple of months. So they're in Thessalonica, more hostility breaks out, they send him over to Berea, and the people in Berea responded favorably to the word of God. But then the Jews, they came from Thessalonica, and what do? They stirred up hostility. They're chasing him all over the place. So they come down, follow him. They stir up hostility against him there. And Paul left Berea under duress, and he headed for Athens. But he left Silas and Timothy behind. You see that in Acts 17, 14 and 15. Presumably left them behind to instruct the new converts in the faith. See, Paul was the lightning rod. He was the man. So he took all the heat. He could leave Silas and Timothy behind and let them strengthen the saints. But Paul sent word back for Silas and Timothy to join him in Athens as soon as possible. Now, while he's in Athens, he engages the philosophers there. You see, and you always hear people talk about how Paul adapted his thing and all that. But don't miss this fact. When Paul engaged the philosophers, he called them to repent in light of the fact that the one true God has set a day on which he'll judge the world in righteousness by the man he has appointed, the assurance of which was that he raised that man from the dead. So Paul didn't sit here and go, let me culturally accommodate so that I say nothing. Paul said, listen, you need to repent. I don't care who you are. Stoic? You want to be, Epicurean? I don't care what your label or your philosophy. The truth is, you need to repent because God has appointed a day when he's going to judge this world, and he's going to judge this world by the man he's appointed. And he gave proof to everybody by raising him from the dead. Now, when they heard about resurrection, you see, I told you the pagan world didn't go for that. Afterlife, fine. Continuing to exist, fine. Resurrection, ixnay. So there were some of these people that said, listen, this guy's crazy. But some of the people there were interested, and others within the city joined him and believed. Now, it seems that Silas and Timothy, or maybe just Timothy, it's not clear, but it seems that one or both of them joined Paul in Athens, and then Timothy was dispatched to Thessalonica to encourage and strengthen the saints there in the midst of a persecution that they were apparently undergoing. You see that in 1 Thessalonians chapter 3. Silas presumably went somewhere else in Macedonia, or he may have just stayed in Berea. And then Paul left Athens for Corinth, where, of course, the church is founded there, where Silas and Timothy later joined him in Corinth. You see that in Acts 18:5. Now, the three of them, Paul, Silas, and Timothy, are said to have preached Christ among the Corinthians in 2 Corinthians chapter 1, verse 9. So they all join him. He's there. They join Paul in Corinth. All of them preach there. Now, Paul's condition when he arrives in Corinth is reflected in 1 Corinthians chapter 2, verse 3, where he says, I came to you in weakness and fear and with much trembling. Why would that be? Have you been listening? Listen to what Paul's gone through. Not knowing what's going to happen to him, wherever he goes. But he says that. Now, Paul met Aquila and Priscilla in Corinth. This is a Jewish Christian couple that had been expelled from Rome under the edict of Emperor Claudius. That edict was in AD 49. So it's sometime after that. Paul is there. He stays in Corinth over a year and a half. And it's there that he writes 1st and 2nd Thessalonians. Right? The letters he writes now back to the church that he founded in Thessalonica. And the Jews dragged Paul before the proconsul Gallio, which is a very important thing for dating Paul, because this is a secure date that we have within a very narrow window. So they draw, he wasn't there that very long, Gallio. So they dragged Paul before the proconsul Gallio and charged him with persuading people to worship God contrary to law. But Gallio refused to entertain this. He saw it as a religious dispute. He said, you can't expect me to jump into the religion stuff and start arguing, Jewish rabbis and all this stuff. Well, we have that same doctrine, although it's evaporating in our laws. But there is a doctrine that says, look, you're not going to get entangled in deciding religious matters. So when something comes before a court, the court is to abstain from ruling on those kinds of things. We'll see what the future holds about that. But the Jews then beat Sosthenes, the ruler of the synagogue, who'd become a Christian. Now, Paul stays in Corinth a good while longer. I got just a little bit. Stick with me just a minute. All right, he stays there just a little while longer, and then he headed this because I want to finish. And then he headed back to Antioch, and Priscilla and Aquila, they accompanied him. You see, they went with him to Ephesus, where Paul made only a brief stop. He promised to return if it was God's will. And he did go, though, it says, into the synagogue and reason with the Jews. He does that in Ephesus. Paul leaves Priscilla and Aquila in Ephesus. He then sails to Caesarea. He goes up to visit the church in Jerusalem. And then he returns to the church there in Antioch. And now we're probably 51, 52 A.D. And it's not long before he heads out on his third missionary journey, which we will pick up in the next class, which will not be for 3 weeks. So something else is going. Next week is Mission Sunday. And then next week is relatable, and somebody else is speaking in the class. And then third week, Lord willing, we'll pick back up with the third missionary journey. Thanks for hanging in.